Welcome everyone. Well, today's speaker is Daniel Ruiz. You probably, most of you probably know him already. But he's in the last year of his PhD. Okay, and today he will present us the models he derived and used to study the Posidonian the growth of clonal plants and the different dynamical regimes he studied. So, go ahead.
Thank you very much for the introduction. As he said, I'm going to talk about some of the results I have obtained in my PhD and some applications of a simplified model that we have for the describing the growth of clonal plants. This is the outline of my talk. First, I'm going to introduce a bit the system we study, the plants we study, and why are important from the physical point of view, and which model we use. And I will show you how we can derive this model to a more simplified description. And I will present some results with this simplified model about vegetation fronts and how one can explain the formation of patterns due to the diffusion of toxic compounds. So this is the plant we studied. This is Posidonia oceanica. It's a clonal growth plant that is endemic from the Mediterranean and grows very slowly from huge meadows under the sea, and it's the basis of the ecosystem. Many organisms live there, and yeah, it's very important to know how's the distributions because affects many levels of the ecosystems. It's also important because protect the beaches and it's important for tourism and protects the beaches from the hydrodynamics. I show you also other plants that I will mention along the talk in order you to know what I'm talking about. This is Tostera marina and this is Modelfea nodosa, and are also clonal growth plants. And basically, these marine plants can, here you can see in green, the presence of Posidonia oceanica, and in pink you can see Timotheca nodosa. And you can see that there are patterns that emerge in regions of kilometers, in huge regions. If we make a zoom from here, you can see there is pentic structure. You can see holes embedded in a homogeneous meadow, and you can see more elongated shapes here and here. You can see patches. I mean, there is plenty of structure. You can see also, this is the Poyensa Bay, and you can see Timotheca nodosa also have patterns, and you can see for the same depth, you have a coexistence of different types of patterns. Another kind of patterns we can see, this is Cabrera, this is Posidonia oceanica, is these holes without vegetation, these circular holes embedded in a homogeneous meadow that are, they have size of tens of meters, 30 meters or so, and you can find it in different places. This is the Adriatic Sea in Croatia, and you can see here another localized structure or hole or fairy circle relating to the terrestrial ecosystems. Okay, we want to understand how this process emerges, how this distribution in space of the vegetation forms. And first, what we have to do is to understand the growth of the of clonal growth plants. I'm going to distinguish between two parts of the plants. This is the rhizome here, and you have developed some shoots, these points here. And the first part of the plant that is colonizing space It's called the apex. And you can describe the growth of clonal growth tanks with three mechanisms of growth. First, the rhizome elongates and develops the abscess moves and develops a new shoot behind. This is done with a given velocity, and the distance between these shoots is rho is a well-defined distance. The second mechanism is the branching process. This rhizome can develop a new branch in another direction given by the separated with the original one by an angle phi sub p, and it happens with a given rate omega p. And the third mechanism is death. These plants have a lifetime and eventually can die. Then with this mechanism, Tomás developed a model, a discrete model that takes into account the growth of the meadow, and you have this elongation of the rhizome. You can generate new branches and shoots can die, and with this mechanism you can develop a meadow, the growth of a meadow. But since you have to take into account all the shoots, it's not suitable for studying huge distances, that it's what you need to understand the formation of patterns, as you have seen in the maps. So what we did was to derive a coarse grain model based on these three mechanisms, and here I explain you the different terms of the partial differential equations that describe the density of apices at position r growing with the direction of growth given by this angle here at t, and the shoots at the given position at t. The first contribution is the mortality. The plants can have a given rate of mortality. And the second contribution is the due to the growth of the rhizome. You have that the density of apices growing in this direction can be affected with in the direction of growth. And those apices that move leave behind a shoot, and it's contribute to the growth of the shoots. And the third part is the branching process. Those plants that grow in the direction pi plus phi b, pi b, can contribute, can branch and contribute to the direction pi that I'm describing. So the mortality in general is a complicated function of the density, and you have an intrinsic mortality. It is the lifetime of the plant, the rate, death rate. You have a term, a saturation term, that gives you the maximum density of plants you can have. And the growth in a given region can be affected by regions in the surroundings. And we take into account this with a kernel that a priori we don't know which are the main part. I mean, we don't know how it's the interaction across the space, but we put facilitation to Gaussians, a term of facilitation and a term of competition. And quickly you can see doing a linear stability analysis that you need long range competition in order to have patterns. And at this point I want to know something. You have two equations, and you have two variables for space and one for the angle. So you have effectively a 3D model that it's very hard computationally. I mean, we use 8 directions of growth because the plant branches with 45 degrees, and you only need to use 8 directions of growth to describe how the plant. Yeah, I want to remark that it's the computational cost is big. So
in the previous equation, n is the total number of so na is the number of apex, and s the number of shoots, and n t the total number.
Yeah, it's the sum of all the apices growing in all the directions. It's this integral, right? And then plus the shoots. This is the total density.
And in the question for the depth, you don't have any temporal derivative.
Here.
Yes. So is that?
The I mean, the depth rate depends on the on the total density. I mean.
But the depth rate does not appear to you in the question.
Is this here? I haven't put the NT here for simplicity. I mean, the depth is proportional to the density. I mean,
so this is the depth as function of the number. So this is
the
W is function of NT.
Exactly.
Is what you mean.
And it's the sum, and NT is the sum of apices and shoots. It's the whole, all the shoots and apices. Okay, what we can obtain from this model. If the mortality is high, very high, the only possibility is very short, no plans. On the other hand, if the mortality is, the intrinsic mortality is low, the only possibility is an homogeneous meal, all is covered.
Mortality here is mortality itself, or it's a balance between mortality and growth?
Here it's mortality.
Mortality alone.
Later you will see that in the simplified equation is the balance.
Mortality, you mean the intrinsic mortality?
Yeah, like the lifetime of the plant being isolated from the other plants. So, in between, when the branching and the mortality are of the same order, the long-range interaction, the long-range competition plays an important role, and you can have that the homogeneous solution can become unstable to modulations. It is, you have, for example, an homogeneous density, and you have perturbation, and since they are competing, these plants that are here compete stronger with this part here because they have more density. So these guys decrease and this can increase. So you have a feedback process because now they have more density and compete even stronger. And this feedback process gives you modulations of the density with the space. And with time, this arranges itself and forms an hexagonal, can form different patterns depending on mortality. You can have holes arranged in an hexagonal lattice, stripes or spots or patches in an hexagonal lattice. And you can have also localized patches or localized holes. This case here would correspond to the Fabi circles that I have shown, the circular holes embedded in a mirror that I have shown before. So here I show you some simulations. This is starting from initial condition, an homogeneous initial condition, and you develop a pattern. And in the other case, you start from this initial condition, and you increase mortality, and you can have patches. You develop patches for this mortality. Okay.
The only relevant parameter is that that quotient of between the branching and this is the only relevant parameter.
What do you mean by relevant?
I mean, you can have different phase diagrams, or you have only have that diagram.
I mean, you can change this part. I mean, we use this as a control parameter, and we see different patterns. But you can change, for example, the strength of the kernel of the competition, and you can see also increasing competition, how these different patterns appear for different values of this parameter. Yeah.
And it changes very, change a lot, or?
Too short.
You will see a phase diagram later, but for example, the patterns, we haven't done all the branches for different values of the of this parameter, for example. You can see how the modulation instability, I mean, the region unstable to pattern changes with this parameter, for example. Yeah.
Sorry, are you going to explain later on why they get there? Why they don't look?
This is the last part of the talk. And
but I've seen the model many years, but I still don't understand why non-locality.
Yeah. This is, I mean, we made ourselves the same question. What's that? And we have different hypotheses. And I explore in this talk one of the hypotheses. And it's the last part.
So sorry. The discrete model has same phenomenon.
It doesn't have patterns because there is no disinteraction. I mean, it can describe the growth of an homogeneous middle, but if you don't put the kernel, well, you can do it, and you don't have patterns. If you put the kernel, yeah, it must be it, and you can have the patterns.
Can I also say, what's the relevance of the depth? How deep is the sea? I mean, do the plants grow deep?
This will change, like in our model, will change the mortality, the intrinsic mortality, let's say, because there is less light when you increase the depth, and this can change, for example, this. I mean, we don't have, unfortunately, the relations with all these parameters with variables that you can measure from the coast. But, serious question?
I was worried about if you have a boundary condition. That's simply because of the depth of the sea, because it's deeper than the plants just live in a narrow region close to the coast.
The plants, this Posidonia oceanica goes from 5 meters of depth to 40 meters of depth. Okay. So you can see how the pattern changes as you increase depth. Okay, what are the interesting things to look at this model? The first thing is we would like to know from this bifurcation diagram I show you where you have all the patterns, we'd like to know the unstable parts of these branches of stationary solutions. Why? Because these branches gives you important information about the dynamics. For example, if you have the unstable branch here will give you which is the minimum density you have to plant in order to the plant to succeed, number of plants you need to succeed. Another thing is we would like to understand the dynamics of vegetation fronts. This is a simulation of Thyma oceanodoxa that wanted to reproduce this sudden increase in mortality. We put in this increase in mortality to reproduce different patterns that you see in the coast. This is at the same depth, and you see there are two patterns coexisting, and can be explained as different regions with different mortalities. Okay, but yeah, we want to understand how is the dynamics of these kind of fronts. This is another important thing. Yeah. And the last part is about the kernel. People want to change. We want to have a mechanistic explanation of which is the reason of this interaction. Okay, and the fact is that with this model, since it's hard from the computational point of view, it's difficult to get some results. And furthermore, if you look at the patterns, it doesn't seem to be affected by the dynamics of the angle. And the question arises, like naturally, is can we find a simplified version of the model only describing the total density? And the answer is yes. Okay, here I show you a simplified version of the model that Emilio and Damia proposed, and Francesca Schonsberg studied in her master's thesis. And basically, it's based on the symmetries of the problem. You want to have the same kind of bifurcation diagram, saturation term for the density, a balance between the depth and the birth term, and some term that gives you facilitation. You have two terms that are the responsible of patterns and appear from a derivation of from a approximating the kernel with a moment expansion approximation. You need a term that favors the populated solution against the unpopulated solution because of the growth of the apices. We call this advection because come from the advection in the full model. It's not a clear advection. They added this term that finally doesn't appear. And just because it has the same order and it should appear in a systematic derivation. And yeah, it was studied in the master thesis. And she showed that basically the dynamical regimes are the same. You can have homogeneous solution becomes unstable, develops patterns, and you can have hexagonal negative hexagons, positive hexagons, spots, and holes and stripes. You can have everything the same.
I mean, I have the same question. There are at least 7 or 8 parameters.
Yeah, you can. I mean, you can remove some dimensionalizing. Okay. And you basically, I mean, here you study, for example, this is the phase diagram. This is mortality, and this is this facilitation. And here you have the region in the phase diagram where you are unstable to patterns. This curve here is this saddle node bifurcation. And in this region here you have homogeneous solution. And here you have zero solution. So they noticed this model is structurally unstable because doesn't dump the big weight numbers when the density is zero, this line here, this tail line. And they added some diffusion to avoid that. And they have this this phase diagram. And I wanted to compare with the full phase diagram of the full model, and this one, and that way, because the parameters are different. And you have here the saddle node. It's difficult to see. And you have this one. And what we see is that we have the same dynamical regimes. We have the homogeneous solution becoming stable to patterns, and this modulation stability approaches to the saddle. So the question at this point was, can we derive this equation and give a relation between parameters? And yes, again, I'm going to show you how we do this derivation. This is the full model. And we want to remove the angle. We only want to describe the density, the total density. So first step, what we do is we do a Fourier series in the angle. We can define this vector here as the amplitudes of the first mode. And the modulus is this capital A. And if one plots the simulation of the density, for example, you can see here the average density of apices. Here are the apices that go to the right. Here are the apices that go to the left. And here you see this capital A, this amplitude of the first mode. And in blue you see the amplitude of the second mode. And since this is small, you can say, okay, I can truncate the series. And if you do that, you have that the series, you can rewrite it in a different way. You have the average density, that is this blue curve here, and you have a modulation in the angle. So there are directions that have more density than the average, and directions that have less density than the average. And the direction that have maximum of apices is given by this angle. This is the first approximation. The second is assume that the apices and shoots, that when you have the homogeneous solutions are proportional or related, you can assume this relation holds even when the homogeneous solution, when you do not have an homogeneous solution. It's wrong, but you can test if it's too wrong or not, and you can see this is the theoretical relation, this one here, and in blue you have the simulation, and it's quite good. You can think, okay, let's try the simulation. Let's try this approximation. If you include these conditions here, you can derive, you can write an equation for the total density, this nt, coupled with this amplitude, the two components of the in Fourier, the first bound, and you can write this in polar coordinates, and you have this amplitude, the capital A, and this angle. This has a fixed point for this angle, and quickly goes to this fixed point. What means that? You have this fixed point is related with the angle formed by the gradient. Here you have the angle and the gradient of the density, the total density, and A forms this angle theta with the x-axis. When this reaches the fixed point, this is what happens. That this vector is aligned with the gradient of the density. So it means that basically you have more apices growing outwards the middle than apices growing inwards. I mean, you have here is a bit darker. These are the apices that grow precisely in this direction. And with this, since they have the same direction, we can say they are proportional. And we don't know this proportionality constant. I mean, it will depend on many things, would be complicated. But we can consider the first approximation, just. And if you put this here, you can obtain this closed equation for the total density. And these terms here are due to the clonal growth of the plant. Basically due to branching and the advection of the region. And the last part is the derivation is to the kernel that is inside here. You can do a moment expansion of the kernel, like this. This should be a force, sorry. And basically you have the second derivative and the fourth derivative. And just quick. You can find the whole equation. You have a linear term, quadratic and cubic terms, nonlinear diffusion, a nonlinear fourth derivative, the gradient to the square, and diffusion. And you can obtain these parameters in an approximated regime.
The kernel that you're considering is has an exponential form, right?
It's formed by two Gaussians, and it's like a Mexican hat.
Ah, so the exponential that you have
is here, and the expression is not.
Okay.
Not here. This is
exponential, and then
this part is
the moment expansion.
This part was only to avoid having a mortality term that creates plants. Just to have that is always positive. The mortality is positive and doesn't create.
No, it's okay.
But
it's always an exponential.
It's a simulation of the facilitation. You cannot facilitate infinitely.
So you yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't understand why you did the last approximation.
In fact, I studied the equation with kernel and without kernel.
No, I mean,
which one?
The previous slide with the coefficient that you use.
This one.
You can determine
this C?
Yes.
No, I don't think so, because it depends on
you don't have an expression for it?
No, I haven't managed to do that. And I tried, but.
That depends on the profile. And you don't have an expression for the profile.
Yes. But you maybe can expand it. Because you are assuming some kind of solution for the profile.
You assume the profile, but it's complicated.
In fact,
so
it doesn't matter a lot because you don't want a lot of terms here. You want a simple description.
Yeah, but it's saying that you have new parameters. You can
determine.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, maybe I have C0 and D0. D0 is multiplied with this term. Maybe.
When you assume
this
what do you need to know with the coefficient for the four-quarter term?
Which one?
Well, I mean, when you do expansion for the kernel,
yeah.
But the kernel, at the end you assume a nonlinear coefficient in front of the fourth order term.
This part?
Yeah.
I mean, this is because the kernel is multiplied, I mean, okay. Comes from here, it's proportional to the density.
Okay. It's not linear.
Yeah.
Yeah, this shape is like, okay. Can be linear in the density. Yeah, it appears. Okay, in fact, I'm not going to consider this last approximation in this work. I mean, we studied this equation, but we studied also the equation with the kernel, and this is what I'm going to do in the following slides. And yeah, you have the equation, the simplified equation with the terms that come from the clonal growth, the rhizome elongation and the branching. You have the terms of mortality, including the kernel, and you have the branching contribution. I mean, you can relate these parameters with the original parameters of the model. So what we can do with this simplified equation? For example, we can do continuation. We can obtain the unstable branches of the bifurcation diagram. Here is the case of 1D. You see the homogeneous solution becomes unstable two patterns, and you see this in green. You see the solution of stripes, and but you can see also you can obtain also localized structures. This is the holes or the fairy circles shown before, and we can see also patches. And now we have these lines that we wanted that give you a threshold for the density that you have to plant and so on. Gives you a lot of information on the diagrams. Okay, we can obtain some things in 2D. This is a work in progress. These are the in yellow negative hexagons. These have folds here, it's a complicated thing. I don't have the stability yet. And in blue, you have positive hexagons. And if you want to see what are these folds, for example, for negative hexagons, you have these holes here. You are here in this point. You increase mortality, the holes become bigger and bigger, and they touch. They form these strange triangles. They become round around here, and they form like this pattern here, where you have patches ranging in hexagonal pattern with some patches missing, and the wavelength have changed. And later, if you continue the branch, you change from this state to a state of rectangular. This force will be, or we think will be unstable, but it's something to be analyzed. You can look at the positive hexagon branch, and you have the same. The patches become bigger, they touch, they form these triangles that become round. And you have this hexagonal pattern with two holes missing, yeah, around here. Okay.
What? So there is something that is surprising is that you simplify the model, mm-hmm. but then you find
complicated things.
Yes, complicated.
I mean,
even
no, the complicated things are also in the full model, but I cannot obtain it because I cannot obtain this. Solutions because since the model is more complicated, it doesn't fit in the computer, basically.
Okay.
But they are.
What is surprising is you find singularity.
What do you mean by singularity?
Triangles or something. So you are regions.
It's not a singularity.
Converges.
Yeah, it's something that would be unstable, a solution that it's.
It's not really terrible.
I mean, it's a theoretical solution, a stationary solution that is unstable. It's like putting like a pencil in a vertical, something like that. Okay. Another thing we can do is study fronts. And in 2D, it's a complicated thing because you have many possibilities. You can have the homogeneous solution with the zero solution, this front here. You can have a pattern connecting the stripes, for example, with the zero solution, or you can have stripes connected with hexagons, and you can, in principle, you can study how these fronts will evolve in time. But Yeah, in fact, you can have also three states combined and you have two fronts. But we want to study the most simple case. Let's start by the beginning. And I'm going to look at these three fronts. An homogeneous front connecting the solution of the homogeneous populated solution with the unpopulated solution. A front connecting the stripes with the homogeneous populated solution. And a front connecting the stripes with the unpopulated solution. Okay, and I'm going to distinguish, they can be distinguished from the theoretical point of view, two types of fronts, a pulled front and a pushed front. A pulled front is a front that is formed between a stable state and an unstable state. And a pushed front is a front connecting two stable states. The difference is important because you can analyze the pulled front looking at the growth of the perturbations near the unstable state. I mean, if you look at the perturbations and you go to the reference frame and you consider the wave number to be a complex number, you can, because you have the periodicity given by the real part of the wave number and the decay given by the imaginary part of the wave number, and basically now the growth is this thing here that depends on the velocity, and you can ask which is the in which conditions I have zero growth, which is the marginal situation, and which is the maximum of the dispersion relation in this in the moving reference frame. And with this, if you write complex and imaginary part, you separate, you can find the marginal instability criterion that are three equations that relate the velocity, the real part of the wave number, and the imaginary part of the wave number. Three equations, three unknowns. You can solve the system and you can compute the velocity of this kind of fronts using this linear calculation. Okay, you cannot do that for the push fronts because the mechanisms are driven by nonlinear mechanisms. Here I show you a pulled front, one I showed before, and this state is unstable and develops these patterns with time. Here in red, you can see the velocity of the of a pulled front, in this case, and in this point you have the modulation stability. Here the homogeneous solution changes, this is unstable and here is stable, and you can see that this kind of front persists even in the region of when you have two stable states. And here this you have the same kind of front, but now is a pushed front because it's driven by nonlinear mechanisms. It's pushed from behind, let's say.
What is the time scale?
I didn't put it here, but again, I mean, you can see, for example, the velocity of this front is meters, like centimeters a year. Reasonable with the growth of Posidonia oceanica. All the dynamics of Posidonia oceanica, it's very slow. Okay, and here the velocity goes to zero, and it can be, it coincides with the region where you have localized structure, it's the pinning region, and it is known that here the velocity goes to zero. Okay, here I show you another pushed front connecting the patterns with the homogeneous unpopulated solution. And you can see this part here is basically driving the front and determines mainly the velocity. And here you can see the velocity changing the control parameter. And you can see here that the velocity is zero because it coincides with the pinning region where you can have isolated patches that are stable. And when you go to this part here, this front is unstable and the homogeneous front prevails. This is the homogeneous front. Okay. I've reached the last part of the kernel.
This Globosity is still present for two, omega whatever is this axis that I cannot read, and the stable state disappears very for sure, no?
I mean, when the velocity goes to zero.
The red line that you have on the order, you find connects the stable state, up at the stable state with the zero. No?
This one?
And up at the stable state disappears at 1.2.
I mean, this. No, this is this point corresponds to the previous front. The front connecting the stripes with the zero.
Ah, so these are not the velocity of what you are showing.
Exactly. And these three points correspond to the homogeneous front. But in this here, there is a change of stability. The homogeneous, the stripe, the front connecting the stripes with the zero solution, it's not stable anymore.
Yes.
And the homogeneous front prevails. If you put an initial condition of stripes,
so
you develop homogeneous solution.
So the velocity for at 2, yeah, this one,
this point corresponds.
Which corresponds to force connecting what?
Stripes with the zero solution. And here you enter the pinion region.
Because you fixed all these kinds of.
Yeah, because if you start from a delta, you, in this regime you see stripes,
but
and in this regime you see.
Because for instance, for. Okay. In the region where you have put there the white line, you also have a front connecting stripes and zero. So you should have 2 points there.
Here you have stripes and zero. Yes, but you enter the.
And stripes and upper homogeneous. So you should have at least three velocities for that part.
Yeah, but you have. Here you have the pinion region. I mean.
In general, you could have more than one single velocity if you put all the possible.
Yeah, you have in fact three velocities for the three fronts. Here I show you the two, but I said that these three correspond to the homogeneous solution because the stripes with the zero become unstable, and if you put the same initial condition of stripes connecting the zero, it will develop homogeneous and will let the middle part with the stripes. I mean, the homogeneous solution prevails. That's the reason why I put it all together, because although you look at one front, the other appears. But yeah, maybe it's not the best way to plot it. I can agree. So I'm going to change to the last part. In the question, we would like to know which is this mechanism that gives rise to long range competition. And basically, we have two hypotheses in mind. The first is hydrodynamism. And the second one is the diffusion of a toxic compound that acts like a long-range competition. And I want to explore the second one, this diffusion of a toxic compound. Which are the evidences of these toxic compounds? The biologists know that the presence of sulfides made the growth decrease or increases the mortality of the plant, poisons the plant. And they also know that these sulfides are generated because organic matter decomposition. I mean, you have more organic matter, you have more sulfides. It's a nice way to see it. And basically, there's another reference where they show there is this vegetation rings, and they measure the presence of sulfides along a radius, and they see that these rings are correlated with sulfides. There is something here, I mean, there's a relation between the spatial structures that can appear, the patterns, and the presence of sulfide. And we want to explore that. This is the following. We have a meadow that releases the leaves, and these leaves can diffuse, can travel to the surroundings, into water movement, whatever, we think of this as a diffusion. And this organic matter can decompose and generate sulfides in the sediment that later are toxic to the plant in the surrounding or to itself. So we use the model of clonal growth, now without the kernel, and we write another equation for the concentration of sulfides. The production of sulfides is proportional to the death plant, to the mortality of the plant, the death plants, because these generate organic matter. These sulfides can disappear in different ways, and we have diffusion of sulfides. And we put that the mortality of the plant is proportional, it had the same terms as before, and is proportional to the presence of sulfides. More sulfides, more mortality. And basically, if one simulates this equation, one can see this acts like a long-range competition, and you can have patterns, and we can have more things. We can have oscillations of the homogeneous solution. Here I show you a bifurcation diagram of the model, and here is the saddle node of the homogeneous solution, and you can see that there is a Turing bifurcation. In this region you are unstable to patterns, and this the saddle node and the Turing approach, like in the full model. And furthermore, we have a region where the homogeneous solution is unstable to oscillations in time. You have a Hopf bifurcation. I mean, the parameters of the model you can obtain from the previous references, but yeah, you have some error, and basically you can obtain that oscillations and patterns are present at the same time. We have changed a bit the parameters to see how the system responds, and I have presented here some phase diagram that has different scenarios, that only has patterns, only has oscillations, and the two things together. Yeah, but even so, even with this, you have the parameters are reasonable. You have a good order of magnitude.
So the place where there is a stable state with one's living is the one on the bottom.
If you do that here, yeah. You have plants here, yeah. You have a homogeneous solution. Pattern, this is the saddle.
And what you have is over there. You go to the zero solution.
Here you have the zero solution.
Okay.
Yeah, you have this that at this window here.
Then you have pattern.
Then you have pattern.
What is the homogeneous stable?
I'm going to show you some simulations. Here you have the formation of a patterns. As all the simulations for Posidonia, the time scales are long. And yeah, you can see a pattern forms, and you can see how the sulfides relate with the density. You can have also localized structures or
in orange is sulfides.
In orange is sulfides and in green is vegetation. And yeah, you can see also how the sulfide concentration relates with the density here. And this would be something to measure in the real holes, because you can, in order to do the profile.
There is something that maybe problematic, that and it's very sensitive to the concentration of the sulfide. So it's then difficult to model something that is very sensitive. Any change to the parameter,
this is one of the things that we have, that we can change, I mean, using the parameters that we get from the references, changing the bit, you change the scenarios. I mean, you can have Hopf and Turing at the same time, you can have one of them. And yeah, this is one of the problems we have, that the measurements they have are not super accurate.
I guess that the point of NAS is that if you look at the concentration of sulfides, it goes from 6.5 to 5.5. So a small concentration of sulfide makes a big difference.
Yes.
And this is about 10% of the total concentration that will make a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
And so that we saw.
You could noise or something.
No, but the point is that it's not that you go from sulfide from 0 to 10 in whatever the scale. You go from, in the scale, you go from 5.5 to 6.5. So the change around the mean value is of plus minus 10% on the concentration. Mm-hmm. That's, I guess, that.
Yeah, that's the system very difficult to study. I went for far with it, not so far.
The dynamics of the survival is so slow. Some of these also.
No. Depends on the regime you are.
But you need that. You need that the supplies go in such a slow time scale. No?
He wants to know if you can eliminate the second equation.
Probably you can. Probably.
Yeah, probably.
What is the decay rate of the supplies in time?
I don't remember. Talking about that.
But you need to the supply to be there for some of the years?
Are they?
No.
I mean, in these simulations, I think it's faster than the evolution of the vegetation, but it's more or less they have the same time scale.
Probably.
I mean, you can do it, but you have to linearize the. I mean, the dependence of the. I mean, the sulfides must be. They have to have a linear dependence of the density to find that you have like an exponential kernel that gives you.
You do that, you go back to the exponential kernel.
Yeah.
Or fusion.
Yeah, yeah. What more? Okay, we have oscillations on the origin solution.
And then you don't have the. Well, if you put the kernel, you don't have the oscillations.
So I mean, the yeah. Yeah, exactly. This is one of the reasons why.
And in those thermodynamics, I think they are probably.
Yeah, now you will see that maybe you cannot eliminate in all the cases these variables. You see, for example, that these parameter regimes is close to homoclinic transition, and you see the period that it's like longer. It becomes, the dynamics becomes very slow here and over here. Yeah. Later goes, does this quick oscillation. You can see that this oscillation can generate, it's unstable to patterns, and now it will grow, but you start to see some modulations. And yeah, the cycle becomes unstable to patterns, and later the oscillation stops when the pattern is formed. Now you will see. Now you see how the density of plants grow. Okay.
You can come back to the question of you may remove the diffusion. It seems that you can remove the diffusion.
What do you mean? You can.
Efficient of the.
No. That's what gives you the balance.
Exactly. I mean, this is what you give, what gives you the long range competition.
When I see this, it diffuses the. Oh, okay. That was.
The diffusion of the density.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
The diffusion of sulfides.
Yeah,
make
a couple.
But, okay, now let's focus on the oscillations and the homogeneous solution, the oscillations of the homogeneous solution, because it's important for the next part. Here you have the homogeneous solution, and you have a Hopf bifurcation. You see here the cycle, these sulfides and shoots. Here you have the time evolution, and I'm changing this parameter, and you see how the cycle is growing when I increase the parameter, and at some point it will decrease again, and the Hopf disappears, and you have later the sad node, and here you have the density goes to zero. And you see how this cycle approaches to zero, and the period becomes longer because we are close to an homoclinic transition. You see, and here's the sad node, and if we look for another parameters, we can find the homoclinic transition. You can see the cycle again, but at some parameters, you will see that this point here touches the saddle node, the unstable fixed point, and it's the homoclinic transition. And you see that approaching to this transition, the period becomes larger, and you lose the cycle. And in this regime, in this window here, you have excitable dynamics. Because if you start from a density here, you have to do a large excursion here, all the cycle, and later the density disappears. You have this excitability dynamics. Here, if you increase the, with more the mortality, you will see the Hof is, the homoclinic is present again, and you have the cycle. It's very small, but you will see it. The cycle again. You see the cycle. And after that, the cycle. Okay, we have excitability, and why is this important? Because in this region, here is the region where you have excitability after the homoclinic transition. If you put some plants, it will grow, and since you have diffusion, when it decays, it will diffuse and will form like a wave that expands. So if you have radial symmetry, you will have a ring, as you can see here. And this, we think it's the what we see in the Danish gate gap, of these rings of vegetation that leaves sulfides behind. Later, this cycle becomes unstable and develops modulations along the ring, it forms a pattern because it's in the region where you can have also patterns.
So it's the region where the flood forms and the unstable.
Yes, I think so. I mean, I haven't computed the flat front, but I
imagine that the flat front here to be modulation and stable means that when the ring is sufficiently flat, then it develops a simultaneous stability, which is a wave number that the flat front will have if you take a flat front. Mm-hmm. Okay. This is the wave number that will be the wave number that will be yesterday.
Yeah,
I'm not sure.
Yeah, here you see how it becomes unstable and develops some patterns. It's interesting because, or it's nice because you can see these like arcs similar to these things. Yeah, it's beautiful. Okay, I've reached it to the end. Basically, I have shown you that we can simplify like a 3D model with two equations, one simplified version with one equation in 2D, and it reduces the computational cost and allows us to do many things. We can have a relation between parameters of the original model with the simplified, but it's very good because we can map one thing to the other. And I can show you different results in the simplified model. I've shown you the stable and unstable parts of the branches, pulled and pushed fronts of different, connecting different solutions. I have shown you that this competition kernel can be explained as the diffusion of sulfides due to organic matter decomposition. And I've shown you that there are oscillations, excitable dynamics, and these excitable dynamics can give rise to the formation of these rings. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Danny. Well, there's been some questions already, but there is time for more.
In the original model, you have plants that grow and branch. Mm-hmm. And you choose eight directions, because they branch at 45 degrees. Mm-hmm. And you went to a continuous model in which you still have the number of horizons in the different directions that you have started, no?
Yeah.
And then you go to a single model where there is the total number, and although you do this Fourier expansion, and it turns out that the maximum growth rate is perpendicular to the surface. So that means that the original model, the branching doesn't matter if it is at 45, at 20 degrees, or there is no branching at all. Because if the original model just will keep growing in the direction that it had, it will keep growing perpendicular to the surface. So at the very end is what you get. So where it is in the middle of all that things?
I mean, at least for Posidonia oceanica, mm-hmm. the parameters that we have, you can analyze that the dynamics involving the angle doesn't play any role.
So you don't really need to have 8 angles.
Exactly. But maybe for other species that grow faster or so.
I understand. But biology will tell you that that's important. Like you said, well, if you need some more of that grows just perpendicular to the surface, I basically get the same study.
But the angle determines, the branching angle determines the value of the coefficients.
Yes, sure, the parameter. The parameter that then you choose depending on profile, on the depth, on the size, or
the But then if you put an angle which is too, much less than 45, you get an oblique in things, which is not here.
But in the final model, there is no 45.
No, but the final model may not be good for very small angles.
No, there is. There is a, in the parameters. I mean, at least you have
there
this.
There is a growth rate which is perpendicular to the surface. That's it. A parameter that goes on how much it is growing.
Yes,
but there is nowhere that says 45, 25, or 33.
Yeah, in the parameters.
I think that it also depends on the amount of sun. I change the amount of sun, and then I can change the angle.
Yes, maybe the same.
I mean, you have a golden rate that is perpendicular to the surface. If you have no branching, you get the same.
It's good.
No?
Yes,
so it's bottom line for the biologists. Stop studying all these.
To be honest, it was asked as we put the angle, so.
I mean, no.
They do not pay enough, but they study the angle. But then yeah. There are things with there are things that depend on the angle that we don't understand yet. So the model may not be good
for some reasons.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, and we don't know that.
For me, it's very difficult to believe that patterns of fossil energy as a scale depend on the concentration of sulfide, which is something of time scale powers. Influenced by environmental conditions, influenced by turbulence, influenced by. So, can you explain a little bit more what you think about this?
I mean, I cannot assure you that this is the reason.
No, it's your model.
I can. This can be an explanation, but also the aerodynamism can play an important role. I mean, and you don't have a precise parameters to say no, this is. Is right.
No, I don't mind parameters.
No, but I care about the parameters, but they can determine the dynamical regimes you can have.
Well, in sustainable, I don't remember the decay rate of sulfides, but it's large. So the sulfides can stay there for years.
Remember that the sulfides stay on the soil, not in the water.
You have sand, you have summer, you have many things.
This is under the soil, in the roots. So it's a stable sediment. So the sulfides can stay there for 10 years or 20 years.
But you're talking about 10,000
years. No, in Sistema Marina is much faster. Right? In Posidonia we don't know. But in Sistema Marina for which the...
That 10 years is something...
Sistema Marina goes meters per year. Something. Is that correct? What I'm saying?
Goes faster at least.
Goes faster than. So then the scales are not that different of it. Because you can have a plant that can grow 10 meters in 10 years. And the sulfides can stay there for 10 years. So you may get an interaction which is more than 10 meters. In Fostera Marina, in Posidonia is more critical. In Posidonia we do not have evidence that this is a true mechanism.
So I say, it's, for me it's difficult to believe. Eh? You're talking about 10,000 years for part of
the world. The 10,000 years also is not that...
No, it's a decay from a stable state, you start from a...
But it can be much faster.
Yeah.
Depends, because you are close to critical points here, you have slow dynamics and so on. But the temporal scale is...
Yeah, can change with parameters.
I don't know if this is a very stupid question because maybe it wasn't even like you didn't always employ an angle dependent model, right? But sometimes you had 8 angles of 45 degrees and you still got hexagonal patterns. Does that have to do with the fact that with hexagonal patterns you can fill a space and with octagonal not? But then there's some space.
No, I mean, so this the hexagonal patterns do not have nothing to do with the directions of growth. I mean, because I mean this, you start from maybe from an initial condition that you have a lot of plants growing in one direction, but it quickly evolves to a state where you have all the directions equivalent, let's say, and only in the interfaces of the fronts you have differences in the angles. Then for the hexagonal pattern, it doesn't matter.
The hexagons happen in the space, in X and Y.
Yeah.
And the growth direction is another space.
What do you mean by other space?
It's three-dimensional, it's another
dimension. Ah, it's three-dimensional, okay. Yeah,
okay. The patterns happen in the other dimension, so you may not straightforward.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So then, one last question.
What is the biological reason of the branching angle?
I mean evolutionary.
I mean, yeah, yes.
Evolutionary.
Yeah. So I guess 45. If it is round, seemingly random number, I guess it can just be random. But I guess if it's 45 degrees, then there should be some reason, probably some evolutionary reason. It should be reflected in some model. I guess evolutionary model. So
I mean, most of the plants have similar angles to 45. They are narrow plants, let's say, and others that they are wider. But I mean, we haven't studied the evolutionary reason why this angle is more present. I mean, I guess it's something related to the colonization of space.
Exactly, might be the optimum.
Because
they don't know your results before. I mean, this is not an evolutionary model, you know. And I just want to make a final remark because you asked twice for the parameters and Danny didn't respond. We have many parameters, but many are fixed. So the velocity of the apex, the distance between shots, and these kind of things are measured and do not depend critically on mortality.
But you don't choose it. You just take this value because of
you take this value from the measurements of the
okay. Measures. You don't tune it.
They are given. No. Okay. They are given for a space.
The things you can tune are related to the kernel because you don't know them.
Exactly. The kernel.
And the mortality rate depends on.
Yeah, mortality rate.
And then branching and the distance also depends on environmental conditions, but not that strong. So we consider them constant.
But then in the other model that you put A, B, C, D, in that case, you don't have a physical, no? At the end, yes, but exactly. In principle, you don't
principle
have.
You don't know, but the derivation that you show gives you the
relation.
Thank you very much.
Gracias.